So again, we'll stress more on images. This talk is of 10 minutes, but I think maybe extend it about 15-20. Now, long time back, we used to define infective endocarditis as infection of the endocardium. But since lot of intracardiac devices are put, pacemakers, ICDs, catheters, so now the definition has been extended to infection of the endocardium and intracardiac devices by infective organism. I won't show you, will show you some other day that how the pacemaker electrodes have got infected and produced a fever also. So it is the definition. Now there are three things in the diagnosis. A clinical manifestation is very important, don't depend only on echo, blood culture and echocardiography. These are the three main things which is considered in the diagnosis. So a normal heart is relatively resistant. You don't get it usually in a normal heart unless sometimes there is an overwhelming septicemia or so. So otherwise there has to be two important things. A presence of bacteremia, unless there is a bacteremia, from where the bacteria will come, and there should be a source or a nidus of infection on which infection can come. So that is the thing. Some persons 10 days, 5 days fever, they send for infective endocarditis. No. So there should be two things, a source of infection and on where that infection can come. So the nidus is the most important, is a pre-existing pulmonary wall, a pre-existing valvular lesions. So that is why you see infective endocarditis is most common in a valvular heart disease. Prosthetic valves, nowadays because they are put, pacemaker, defibrillators, congenital cardiac lesions, bicuspid aortic wall, somebody was asking the other day, so I told them this is one significant, usually not an ASD, because it is a low velocity flow, because one of the mechanisms of infective endocarditis is a high velocity jet which goes and strikes again their endocardium and tries to damage it, and this is low velocity flow. Drug abusers and immunocompromised patients like AIDS also, but in our day-to-day practice, most common is this, and then some of the congenital lesions also. And of course, if you get a prosthetic wall, then it is something different. Now, I don't want to go into it. You go to the Google, just write modified Duke criteria for diagnosis of infective endocarditis. You will get a major criteria, minor criteria, what is this? Because that you can read from there. Just say modified Duke's criteria for infective endocarditis. We are more interested in rejected diagnosis. Sometimes the patients come, they put a treatment, we are not sure it is infective endocarditis. When do we say it is a rejected diagnosis? Is when there is a firm alternate diagnosis of fever. Suppose today the patient has come with a mitral stenosis or so, and there is a fever. You start putting him on antibiotic. But if you find there is a strong alternate diagnosis to it, then avoid it. Number two, resolution of fever and clinical manifestations within 4 days of antibiotics. This excludes an infective endocarditis. It is such a situation, it may take 1 week, 10 days or so. So if you are finding an alternate cause, or even suppose you have not found an alternate cause, it may be a viral fever or so, but if all these symptoms and everything regresses within 4 days, that means it is not an infective endocarditis and does not meet the criteria. So when do you suspect infective endocarditis? Clinically, it is more important. Presence of a nidus of infection, any valvular lesion, congenital lesion, prosthetic wall, any of these, more. If it is very rare to have it on a normal heart, so presence of a nidus of infection, source of infection, patient might have undergone surgery, patient might have gone catheterization, patient might have got extensive any dental manipulations or so. Unexplained fever, 90% of the cases. Murmur in about 85%. significant constitutional symptoms. It is a very serious disease, toxemia, and some indirect signs. So that these are the things when you suspect it, not that any case of fever you think of infective endocarditis. So this is a very important slide. When do you suspect a infective endocarditis? Suppose there is no nidus of infection, no source, there is an explained fever, the murmur is any fever can have some murmur, any anemia can have a murmur. If these are not present, then you don't think it, but these are some of the important manifestations of infective endocarditis. Now, not going into the details, it has number one, the echo will tell you the underlying heart disease. It will tell you the whether the vegetations are present or not, what is the location, size, and of course a prognostic stratification. So that it tells you whether underlying disease is present or not. Then if you are lucky, you can see the vegetations, and these are, and I think this is given in your book, so let us not waste the time in it. So what are the high risk cases? Which are high risk cases? The more larger the vegetations, increase in vegetation size despite therapy. Isko bhej sakte ho. Increase in vegetation size, hypermobile vegetations, more chances of embolization, presence of complications, previous infective endocarditis, heart failure, renal failure, repaired or unrepaired shunt of the butt. In a day-to-day practice, again, the larger the vegetation, the more mobile the vegetations, and the vegetations present on a prosthetic valves also, they have got a sort of a very poor prognosis. Now, what are the echo criteria? Most important is the motion is more chaotic than the normal valve and independent of the valve. Now, if this that mass moves together with the valve, that means it is most likely not a vegetation. It has got an independent chaotic motion, not related just to the a valve or so, and it is attached to the upstream side. For the aortic vegetation, the upstream side is from the LV side. For a mitral vegetation, upstream side is from the atrial side. Upstream side from where the blood is going toward that. So that is the upstream side. And always see in multiple scan planes, and this problem you will face lot of time, whether it is an active or a healed vegetation. So it is an irregular mass, irregular mobile mass moving with the wall, independent of the wall, attached to the upstream side. For example, a vegetation is attached to the LV side of the aortic wall, that is the upstream side, the blood is going from the LV to the aorta. So normally what will happen, suppose it is the aortic wall and a vegetation is there. In diastole, when the wall closes, the vegetation will come into LVOT. In systole, when the wall opens, it will go into the aorta. Say that because the aortic wall opens in aorta during systole and closes towards LVOT in diastole. So that is the thing, and that we have shown you. You see this is a mass. Now it is, why it is moving less, I will tell you, because it is more of a healed vegetation. But you see, in diastole, it comes into the LVOT, in systole, goes into the aorta. And as a mass which is, and this has to be associated with a clinical feature. This one, what I have been showing you, you see, a mass coming into the LVOT during diastole and into the aorta during systole, and more marked in the presence of a non-coronary cusp, very independent motion. You see a mass in relation to the non-coronary cusp. Can you see it or not? And you can see better here. You see. Can you see better now? An irregular mass attached to the aortic leaflet and coming back into the LVOT and the aorta with an independent chaotic motion. So these are some of the features of the aortic vegetation. This is again a flail leaflet. Again, you see the whole leaflet is coming back into the LVOT. Mitral wall attached to the atrial side of the wall, correct? That is upstream side. And same thing in systole, the mitral wall closes in systole, it will come into the LA, in diastole go into this. So just to show one picture, you see three chamber view, mitral wall attached to the upstream side of the mitral leaflet, irregular mass. Can you see this? Tricuspid wall attached to the upstream mass, independent. This upstream is because it is going towards the tricuspid wall. And now this can be anything. You have to correlate with the clinical picture. I may say it is a tumor, you may say it is a thrombus, but these are the patients who must be having either an IV injections, IV catheter, because it is the tricuspid wall, fever, constitutional symptom. So they should be present. If this patient is asymptomatic, there is no fever, there is no constitutional symptom, then we think that it may be something else. This is the zoomed view, same. So going into the LARA in systole and going into the RV during diastole. Again, same thing, same pattern. So you have seen vegetations in all the walls. Here you see a pulmonary wall, the pulmonary plus mitral vegetation, you see irregular motion again from the upstream side. Irregular motion, and again you see again from the up downstream side, and you see a aortic vegetations here. Any irregular mass also. Very rarely, it is very rare. We normally can't see a vegetation on a transthoracic echo. So in a prosthetic valve, but here you see this patient was running a fever for a long time. There is a prosthetic wall. And you can see this vegetations. Now it cannot be seen from the atrial side because there is a metallic valve also. So normally we always do a transesophageal echo when we suspect it. So a diagnostic sensitivity of a transesophageal is much more as compared to this. So that whenever we are suspecting a vegetation on a prosthetic valve or a devices, we straight away usually go to a transesophageal echo, which is much more informative as compared to these. Diagnostic problem, small vegetation. Theoretically, if you read any textbook, they say if the vegetations are less than 2 millimeters size, you cannot detect it. In any case, it depends upon the quality of the imaging or the resolution of the machine also. And if you do it in very early stage of a disease, then the vegetations might not have developed well. So that is why sometimes we repeat them. And prosthetic wall, again, very difficult to see. Calcified wall, you cannot see because it is very, there are some of the limitations must be given there. This is something known as a Lambert's excrescences. These are small filamental structures. Don't get confused. Kal bhul jana, don't worry. These are very small filamental structures attached to the aortic valve. And they can be confused with a vegetation. And they are much better seen in a transesophageal echo. Now, this we did an echo. Why? Because there was a patient of a HOCM, hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, with a vegetation. And you see, this is the aortic wall, and you see this a linear structure which can be seen in this, which is usually known as a Lambert's excrescences, but forget about it. कि व्हाट मेम्ब्रेन, नो दैट वाज़ द होल मेम्ब्रेन एंड दैट इज नाउ हियर इट इज here it is only related attached to the aortic wall, there is no membrane here. You see this is the aortic wall and this is the closure point and you see a linear structure at the closure point also, but there is no membrane like this. So they, because there is a membrane in those cases.
Sir, in this picture mitral has nothing, sir. Mitral has in this picture.
Previous one? Yes.
Yeah.
I am not showing a transthoracic. Yes, so this was the patient who had come. I have got an MOD imaging also. You see there is a massive thickening of this septum and there was a systolic anterior motion and there were multiple vegetations in relation to the mitral wall. So we did a transesophageal echo, that is the case. Now don't mistake it, these are prominent chordae. Now they are attached to the mitral wall, they are not having independent motion. They are not coming from the atrial side. You see, this is the anterior mitral leaflet and you see a very prominent chordae and the same can be seen here, which sometimes can produce a LVOT obstruction. Now see, this is the anterior mitral leaflet. This is not a SAM of a systolic motion, but this is the prominent chordae which is attached to the leaflet and it can be confused with a vegetation. But why is it not a vegetation? Now patient may not be having any constitutional symptoms. Number two, there may be no MR or anything. Number three, it moves together with the valve. Number four, it is attached to the tip of the leaflet and not from the atrial side. So these are some of the differential diagnosis also. Sometimes atypically located. If time permits, I'll sometime show you. I've got a lot of pictures of this patient. Say this patient was a, you can see this is a repaired VSD. You see, it is a, it, this you cannot understand, but this patient was a VSD, a repaired VSD, and then there may be some masses on the RV side. Can you see the RV side? And the vegetation usually develop on the RV side of the heel of either a treated VSD or an untreated VSD, and you see there are multiple masses that side, atypically located. Again, you see it can be occur in, this is left atrium, a vegetation in relation to the left atrium, and it is going into this, a patient also at a mitral wall, this is atypically located a vegetation. Now you see coming from the LA wall and going through the mitral wall. These are sort of very abnormally located. You can see it in the short AC, you see multiple a rapid flapper motion present in this, in this, in the left atrium also. So these are abnormally located and you see both present in the LA and also in the mitral leaflet. So these are some of the, and these are some of the complications. This only one patient I can show who had a paravalvular abscess. Abscess is, or any abscess or a fluid is an eco-free space. A pericardial effusion is a eco-free space, correct? Similarly, abscess is also an eco-free space. And that was a patient who had an aortic vegetation and there was a gap and developed a paravalvular abscess. So now most important, very important slide, a active with a healed vegetation. Now you get a patient with a vegetation never disappears unless it embolizes. So a vegetation will remain. So the problem is eco-correlation with clinical presentation. If you are getting a vegetation, patient is perfectly all right, there is no fever, no toxemia, nothing, that means it is a healed vegetation. Number two, as the vegetations are treated or they healed, they become reduced in size and they become more echogenic. More echogenic means because they become fibrosed also. And the fibrosis is more like a more echogenic structure. And I said, they usually persist unless they embolize and disappears. Hence, active vegetation may not be seen. That is why it is very important to take a history of the old patient and what at that time or not. For example, here you see, this I showed earlier. Now, this patient, this is a healed vegetation. Number one, it is less mobile, correct? Number two, it is very ecogenic, and the patient did not have any fever or anything. This patient, this he is a doctor, we have been following him for last 2 years. He came with an active vegetation fever, he was treated, now it is still persisting. More echogenic, more less mobile, and it is still persisting and is perfectly hale and hearty. So that means a previous history is very important, current history is very important, and the pattern of the vegetation. So that is what we say, an echocardiogram after the, we are just finishing, after the completion of the treatment, all infective pentapulmatoid have a lifelong risk of a recurrent infection. That is why you have to be very careful. Always have a baseline study for future comparison, which we usually don't have, which tells you about the vegetation's insufficiency, recalled heart rate, BP, cardiac rhythm, and whether TT is sufficient, question mark on imaging. So the basis of this slide is that once there is a patient with infective endocarditis, he or she must keep his or her records with her and always take a history. Suppose we have taken a patient who has got a vegetation, looks like healed. Take a history that did you have anything problem, where you treated for about 4 to 6 weeks with antibiotics. Always take a history. Always correlate with the correct clinical picture. So the practical approach is always correlate with your clinical findings. Echo can be normal in a case of infective endocarditis. Echo can give you a false impression of the endocarditis. Always correlate with clinical picture. Negative echo does not exclude infective endocarditis. It depends upon the size of the vegetation. It depends upon it. You might have done echo at a very early stage of infective endocarditis. And routine case, we do a transthoracic in any doubt, but nowadays we always do a transesophageal echo. Now, so the one of the diagnostic approach in these cases is that when there is a suspected clinical suspicion of infective endocarditis in a prosthetic wall, intracardiac device, go straight for TE. Don't wait for a transthoracic echo or so. If it is a poor quality transthoracic echo, go for a TEE. If you find that there are features suggestive of a prosthetic, of a vegetation, go for a TE. So because in a T you are putting here and there is no imaging interference. If your transthoracic echo is negative, suppose you found it negative and there is the clinical suspicion of infective endocarditis is very low, stop at that time. Even if your transthoracic echo is negative, your clinical suspicion is very high, go for TEE. You are still suspecting it in this, and if the second echo is normal, then you are perfect, no problem in that. So, okay, any doubt? So, we have seen a lot of pictures. I hope you get a mental impression. Aaj jab ghar jana, to just lie down for half an hour. Just lie down. Don't talk to anybody. MR, what were the images shown? That's all. TR, what were the images shown? Make a mental impression. AR, what were the images shown, live images, and infective endocarditis. And if you have a doubt, ask tomorrow, the same image will be shown to you again so that it has got a lasting impression. Correct? Bhai, unko bata do. And for God's sake, read today. Ye to koi fayda nahi hoga. हाँ कल तो नहीं, कल मॉर्निंग हमारा तो इन जयपुर सम ऑफ हिज केसेस हैव बीन पब्लिश्ड इन इंटरनेशनल जर्नल्स एंड ही इज ए फैकल्टी हियर. सो यू शुड स्ट्राइव दैट नेक्स्ट डे यू शुड बी, नेक्स्ट टाइम यू शुड बी सिटिंग ऑन दिस साइड ऑफ द टेबल, नॉट ऑन दैट साइड ऑफ द टेबल. सो देयर वी हैव लॉट, अनफॉर्चुनेटली वी लॉस्ट वन ऑफ आवर कोलीग्स. ही वॉज ऑल्सो, ही कैम ऑल्सो बेसिक कोर्स एंड ही वॉज मैनेजिंग एवरीथिंग अलोन. सो it is all practice, practice, and slightly, slight, go on reading a little bit also. As I always say, the longer the gap between your going from here and starting the echo, the bad it is. So nowadays it is so easy to buy machine, you get loans or so, so usme apna, so have a minimum gap and keep in touch with this. And you are getting the same lecture topics now, which you can see on your mobile. So, आपको उसके lecture topic भी मिल जाएंगे. And on Wednesday, even if our 4 persons are there, we'll start our talk on congenital heart disease on Wednesday. So, try always, we tell them, because Wednesday I have to reach hospital by about 10:30. And congenital date test. And so you tell your organizers to give you an early breakfast and come back by 8 o'clock.